Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Welcome to worship at the Presbyterian Church of Coshocton. If you are visiting with us today, we are so glad that you have come. We have a handmade gift for you. If you raise your hand, an usher will bring it to you. Do we have any visitors today? If so, will you raise your hand? We want you to know that God's love is here for you. Happy birthday to Jeff Gill, Ruth Ann Bush, Susan Gibson. Happy anniversary to Gordon and Kelly Kendall yesterday. Are there any other birthdays or anniversaries this week? This afternoon at 2, you are invited to join a group of us who will be leading worship with communion at Windsorwood. We especially need folks to come and help us sing the hymns. Today we give thanks for those who brought fresh vegetables and non-perishable foods, and those who came on Friday to prepare our harvest table, a thank offering to the Lord. All of the vegetables and non-perishable foods will be given to the Salvation Army Food Pantry tomorrow to help local people in need. I invite Debbie Clark to say a word.
I have two announcements from Presbyterian women. Both are in the assembly room. We have 40 boxes ready to go for Operation Christmas Child, so thank you to all who have helped with that. And also, we have a newly upholstered sofa in the assembly room, so please check that out when you leave today.
I invite Sally Kincaid.
Tomorrow is when we start preparing for the rummage sale, which is probably our biggest all-church project of the year. We'll start setting up tables and the clothing racks and so forth tomorrow morning, and we're setting up things, arranging them until we have the actual rummage sale this coming Friday, the 22nd at 9 a.m., and then Saturday, also at 9 a.m. So we could use your help. It's not too late to sign up. And if you're not able to stand much or lift much, we're going to have baby Layla with us so you can sit and rock her while we work.
That sounds like fun. Sharon Sutton is going to speak about Presbyterian Women Thank Offering Sunday.
Thank you, Karen. Good morning. This, we've heard about so many missions of our Presbyterian women and thankfulness to our Lord for all of the things that are happening in our church. Today, we are giving a special attention to the thank offering that our Presbyterian women have been involved with since 1888. Eliza Coakley of Springfield, Ohio, planted the seed for Presbyterian Women's Thank Offering in 1888 when she urged each woman to give $1 above her usual contribution to the Women's General Mission Society of the United Presbyterian Church of North America. Year after year, women have responded to Coakley's call to give a thank offering to her Lord and have raised tens of millions of dollars for mission at home and around the world. We give thanks that since 1888, our organization has generously and joyfully shared our gifts through thank offering so that others may know God's abundant grace. Presbyterian women have provided the tangible love of Christ through food for children that are hungry, education for women who seek it, support for immigrants who need friends, shelter for those without beds or homes, and healing for patients at home and abroad. We trust that God will continue to work through us and through our gifts. We will never know the countless people who have been the beneficiaries of our engagement in God's mission in the world and in our community. We do know that God has blessed Presbyterian women beyond measure. We have continued to seek to find ways to share God's blessings with others. And we give thanks for this church and our contribution through our organization, Women, but also the support of our men and our families and our children to make this mission a very vital mission in this church. This morning, we have a great honor to have Irene Crawl with us. Irene is going to share with you a mission that came from this church and our women. Irene was our secretary in the late 1970s for 4 years, managed the Good News Bookstore for 37 years, sewing daily for charity projects now, such as Little Dresses for Africa, hospital gowns for hospice, comforters for Mennonite World Relief, and most recently, quilts for women and children at Harbor House in New Philly, a domestic violence shelter for women and children. She's a very active lady and a business, a very busy lady, her sewing machine into the late hours of the night. She's also active in the Church of the Nazarene and Missions and being secretary for the church board. It is my pleasure to introduce to you Irene Crawl.
It is such a privilege to be here. I have a deep love for this church and so many people that I look out here and know. I know a lot have passed that I knew. I always grieve when I read about one of the Presbyterian people that I knew during my years here. So this is wonderful to be here today. I give thanks for Sharon asking me to come do this. But the reason that I've come here to do this is because when the phone rings and somebody says to me, "We have an abundance of fabric. Could you use it?" But I'm all ears because sewing has become my new job. After retirement, I went through a phase of, what in the world will I do? What's my ministry now? I mean, I was with people all the time and books. I loved every day of it. It was wonderful. But it didn't take long before I got involved with the elderly in my church and friends in the community that I knew, and I spent a lot of time visiting with elderly, and that was fine. But then, little by little, I got drawn into quilting. Actually, the quilting part started when the fire happened at Park Hotel and my building was shut down for a complete month. I couldn't work. I had to find something to do. Well, out of that, which has been a while back, I have sewed and sewed and sewed. And as gradually as people hear that I want to sew, they ask me, "Will you do this? Can you do that?" So I've had my fingers in a lot of pies, a lot of different ones. But when Sharon called me and she said, "We have a sewing cupboard with fabric in it from way, way back. We're cleaning out. Would you like to have it?" And I said, "Is it cotton? Because I don't want jersey knits. I don't want double knit. I don't want woolies. I want cotton, because cotton is a staple for all kinds of things." So I said yes, and pretty soon, within a few days, a lovely couple, Dwight and Judy Ogle, came to my house, and my garage got dumped into. And I've had this happen before, and I have a lot of room in my garage, so I stack it up, and then I go through it, and I decide what to keep, what to do. Well, they brought in bags, boxes, and shopping bags full. And it was fun. For me, this is like Christmas. I'm a real scavenger. I love to shop at the factory. I love to feel it. But when people give me fabric, I immediately start thinking, oh, I could do this, you know, it's just, my mind just goes. So anyway, I'm giving thanks today for the women who sewed 50 or 60 years ago. Probably they sewed on days when I worked in the church office and I didn't even know it. Back then, sewing was, I've always sewed, but it wasn't a big deal. I didn't do quilts and everything. So now once you get into something different like this, your whole mind picks up quickly when people say fabric, sewing, dresses and stuff. Well, I was excited not only to have the fabric, but to know that some of this fabric had been laid aside and started for projects by the women here, for missions. In fact, there was one little quilt for a child that was completely done and bound, had the Presbyterian Women's label on the back. So we just added our own, because I work with a group at Janae Hutton that is closer to New Philly. We have some ties with a young woman who directs something there. So we passed that on. Then there was two lovely little quilts in purples. Beautiful little quilts done, pieced so nicely. Not quite big enough. So I found complimentary fabric and put borders on them. We put backing on them when we bind them, and off they went. Since last January, my little group has given about 50 quilts to this center. And these are women with children that have come there, some stayed for quite a while, and others who soon go on to live with family members or in a apartment. But they make it known that this is your quilt, or to the child, you take it with you when you go. And the stories that have come back are heartbreaking, but they're beautiful. The director told my friend Julie, she said, every room has something bright in it now because of your quilts. It may be the only really bright thing in there for them. They've come in a hurry, they haven't brought much. And the children, I would dearly love to see this, but of course this is not a place where people visit. This is kind of hush-hush. But to have a 2 or 3 year old child stand and hold his little quilt or her quilt to them and not let go, it's precious to them, it's theirs. They probably don't have a whole lot that's really theirs. So to me, this whole thing with my connection now to this center is wonderful. And I haven't talked to Kathy Robbins lately, but I know we have a ministry in the community for homeless people and different things going on, but we don't have a shelter. We don't have a domestic violence shelter. I know Vicki Casey has something good going on, and I've taken things there. They don't have a storage room. When the day comes that we have something here locally, I will be on board to help with that, to provide what they need. Right now, they ask for blankets. They're not bulky. Comforters and quilts are bulky. They're warm and wonderful. But I'm very aware that we have needs here, too. But as I've been called and brought into these other things, that has become what I work with. And because I am a hospice volunteer, once they learned I could sew and mend or whatever, then it was hospital gowns, which are not hard to make. They're big and they take time and fabric. But I've done a lot of those, so that's a good thing too. And then years ago, after my husband died, I got involved with the Mennonite Church in Sugar Creek because he was a Mennonite. I'm Nazarene. It's a funny little thing here going on. But I loved his church and I would go often up there. So I began to sew every Wednesday with them, and I still do. They quilt on big frames and give money for the mission work from their hand quilting. I'm not a hand quiller. Too slow. Let me piece. Let me sew with my machine. And then we put a backing on them. We bind them. And this goes for World Relief. I also volunteer one Friday a month at Kindred. That's the Mennonite Relief Center here in Ohio. And I know how they bolt them up and bind them, and they go out in great big packages overseas, these quilts, the comforters more or less that go. So, the other thing I do is Little Dresses for Africa, and that all started and came about because I saw Rachel O'Neill being interviewed on Good Morning America probably 10 or 11 years ago. It had its 10th anniversary this year, and I've sewed with her for 9 years. If this is what I mean when I say a little dress for Africa, basically, it used to be a pillowcase dress. You cut the top of the pillowcase off, turned it down, put ties on it. It was a quick, easy fix. But pillowcases are light colored usually. They don't last much. Sometimes they're already worn. Sometimes they smell like a bed. I don't do that. I've always used good fabric. And when we have the children's moment, I want to talk to them about how important this is. There are so many children that have never had a new dress. So this is a very important ministry, one that my heart is I knew this would happen. I could go on forever talking. But this is, I'm just saying, missions locally or overseas, our hands are busy, and God blesses our hands as we work. Thank you.
Let us worship the risen Lord.
Our opening sentences, sing praises to the Lord, for God has done just gloriously. Let us sing God's praises throughout the earth.
Shout aloud and sing for joy, from the highest peaks to the deepest caverns.
Sing aloud and sing for joy, from the tiniest creatures to the greatest herds.
Shout aloud and sing for joy, in the midst of our joys and our sorrows.
Sing aloud and sing for joy, as we come to worship the God of all creation.
We have grown unknown in the world.
God is building a new heaven and a new earth. The former things will not be remembered or come to mind. Forgiven and free, rejoice in what the Lord is creating in you, in me, in all creation.
Dresses. So that's how this whole thing started. It's been going on for 10 years. So
So the children that get these dresses, they don't have closets full of clothes. This may be their only one or two dresses.
Actually, I've seen a lot of pictures where they might have a raggedy t-shirt and little shorts on, and when they put this dress over top of that, and they tie on the shoulders mostly, or they slip over the head, or they tie in the back. There are no other ways to put them on. They're glad.
Should we use one of your children as a model?
Yes.
Maybe Libby wants to hold up the dress or wear the dress. Maybe I can hold it with you. You can bring your big brother. It's okay. Come on up.
Would you like to hold this up?
Okay.
This is made out of fabric that was donated, just like from the closet here at the Presbyterian.
She's ready to get it off. It's beautiful, isn't it?
Yeah. It doesn't take but a half a yard, two-thirds of a yard to make a little dress. So it doesn't take a lot. We do a lot of these.
If you were in Africa and you only had a little t-shirt to wear, would you be happy if you got a dress made by Irene? Would that make you happy? And what kind of climate do they have? They're not wearing big heavy sweaters this time of year.
No, it's mild, but at times I think the nights are chilly. And I see a lot of pictures on the website of children with three-quarter, like my sleeves, down. So I don't always think about just ties on the shoulder. I've made some dresses that have little sleeves in them, too.
Irene, you brought your globe. Did you want to show them where the dresses
go? I do.
Go?
I want to show you.
Maybe Laura would help us. Would you like to hold this for us?
Could you hold the globe for me? I want to show you where Ohio is in the United States. Turn it up this way. Right about here would be like Columbus, Ohio. And way across to Africa, down in the southern part, is Malawi. Google says about 8,200 miles. So when we mail dresses to Michigan, they get kept for a period of time, and then they're put in large containers and shipped to Africa. And then they unload these in different villages. Malawi is the distribution point.
Irene, if you had to count how many dresses you have made for the children in Malawi or in Africa, how many do you think you've made?
I probably have made 300 or 400, but
we have
sent thousands because some of my friends that have latched onto this, one lady particularly in the Fresno area, has made over 400 for me. She just can't stop.
It sounds like you might need some help in making more dresses.
Anytime somebody wants to learn, I'll come to your house.
Okay. Irene, we're so happy you came today to share your joy with the children.
And I say one other thing too, that even as young as you are, you aren't a missionary going anywhere, but you can give when you get to the shoebox thing, the Christmas shoeboxes that go overseas. That's another way of being a missionary right here at home.
And the children did that last week. They packed shoeboxes. So they're excited about helping children in need.
Yeah. Well, thank you.
Yes.
So
the world is now a ball. Thank you so much. Let's close in prayer. Will you pray with me, kids? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for Irene, using her sewing gifts to help children in Africa. And thank you for giving us many gifts and talents. Show us how we can help people in need. Thank you for your love. In Jesus' name we pray, and everyone said, Amen. I brought cookies to show.
Thank you. Let us pray. God of the earthquake and the silence, quiet in us any voice but your own, that by the power of the Holy Spirit we might hear, and in hearing we might believe, and in believing we might act, making way for your new creation. Amen.
A reading from Paul's letter to the Philippians, chapter 4, verses 1 through 9. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, whom I love and long for, my joy, my crown, stand firm in the Lord in this way, my beloved. I urge Euodia and I urge Syntyche to be of the same mind in the Lord. Yes, and I also ask you, my loyal companion, help these women, for they have struggled beside me in the work of the gospel, together with Clement and the rest of my co-workers, whose names are in the book of life. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say, rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, beloved, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, and if there's anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Keep on doing the things that you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, and the God of peace will be with you. Holy wisdom, holy work.
Thanks be to God.
It was a different world in November 1956 when Margaret Towner was the first woman to be ordained in the northern branch of our denomination. It was a watershed moment for women's equality, says Presbyterian Outlook in its October 7th issue. For dismantling gender power structures within the church and for ordained ministry in the Presbyterian Church. 36 years had passed since the first overture to ordain women as elders and ministers went before the General Assembly in 1920. The same year, women were granted the right to vote in the United States. Margaret's ordination to serve God through First Presbyterian Church of Allentown was not, alas, a call to preach. That would come later when she served other churches. Her first call was to be Minister of Christian Education, overseeing the work of 60 teachers with 910 students. The charge at her ordination has never been forgotten. Be the shepherd of the flock and not their pet lamb. Margaret's ordination was covered by Life magazine with a 5-page spread. The article, A First Lady Minister in Robes of a New Role, contains photos that play up her femininity. One features 31-year-old Margaret standing with arms outstretched in a borrowed black clergy robe as two ladies hem and shorten her sleeves to fit her 5-foot-2-inch frame. Another shows her kneeling before seven severe-looking men of the presbytery, clad in long black robes and white clerical ties, with, I had to look this up on the internet, with the preaching bands, these white pieces of fabric that come down. Scary looking stuff. Another shows her smiling as she sticks her head in the door of a nursery, a small child peering back. Still another depicts Margaret laughing, wearing a strand of pearls, and the caption explaining that an old friend from college, where she had studied pre-med, reminded her that she had once said, "The one thing I will never do is church work." To the objection that the ordination of women will be just another excuse for men to get out of the church, Margaret told Life magazine, "In my mind, there is no ground for men's fears that women will move in and take over their jobs. There is too much work to be done to allow any jealousy." Her main worry at the time was not being kept out of the pulpit, she says, for her ministry was with the children and teachers. What bothers her at the time is that the church has a baseball team, and it's all men, and they won't let her play. "But they will call on me," she says, "when they're in a tough spot in the league." Margaret would later choose not to marry, acknowledging that her temperament wouldn't allow her to serve both church and family. I suspect that she realized she wouldn't be able to do it all in an era in which women were expected, not only by men, but by other women, to do everything at home for her husband and children. Do you agree with me? That might have had something to do with it. While church leadership has been open in the Presbyterian Church to women for more than six decades, gender discrimination persists. I read this in Presbyterian Outlook last month. Female ministers have encountered sexism in a variety of forms, including snide remarks and inappropriate evaluations of their bodies, their hair, and the pitch of their voices. It's no secret that women have a more difficult time finding jobs in ministry and more often work in part-time or temporary positions. The gender pay gap among ministers is wider than the national average for all jobs. It wasn't until Margaret's last call, decades after she was ordained, that she would receive equal pay with her male counterparts. Margaret, now 94 and living in Sarasota, Florida, recalls opposition from both men and women in the church. She did receive letters from ministers' wives who worried that women would take jobs away from their husbands and would be willing to be paid less. She also received letters from men who called her to repent and be saved. She chose well. She chose not to answer these letters or get into a dialogue with other people about their opinions. She says, "I felt that an example of women in ministry would help break down barriers rather than debate. When things got tough," she says, "her friends and family had her back. Successes and affirmations kept her going. And I felt called," she says. "Ordained ministry was my life's work." In our Philippians reading today, we note that the Apostle Paul is supportive of women in ministry. And in spite of his situation of being imprisoned for the gospel, he says in 4:4, "Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say, rejoice." Later in chapter 4, he will go on to tell how he had heard of their concern for him, and assured them that in any and all circumstances, I have learned the secret of being well fed and of going hungry, of having plenty and of being in need. I can do all things through him who strengthens me. Paul is concerned for unity and peace in the Philippian church. He does something that's unusual for him. In Philippians 4:2-3, and that is to name two women, leaders in the church, whom he has heard are not in agreement. This stirs him to urge Euodia, a Greek name meaning success, and Syntyche, Greek for lucky, to be of the same mind in the Lord. He doesn't condemn any specific actions, and he doesn't take sides. Also unusual for Paul, he expresses a desire for a loyal companion of his, possibly Luke, to help them be reconciled. He claims them as colleagues in ministry who struggled beside me in the work of the gospel, together with Clement and the rest of my co-workers. He says that their names are in the book of life. This is the only time Paul mentions the heavenly book of life in his letters, though it's a common belief from his Jewish heritage and will be mentioned numerous times in the New Testament book of Revelation. These two women, in Paul's view, don't need to repent and be saved. They haven't ceased to be among God's faithful. Women have been in leadership in the Philippian church in Macedonia from its beginnings. When Paul shared about Christ with some Gentile women, God-fearers, who met by the river on the Jewish Sabbath to pray. In Acts 16, the Lord opens the heart of one of the God-fearers named Lydia, a dealer in purple, to listen eagerly as Paul shares about the risen Christ. She and her household are baptized, and Paul, Silas, and Timothy accept her hospitality and stay at her home for a while. The command to rejoice in the Lord follows Paul's urging Euodia and Syntyche to have the same mind. In chapter 2, he had urged the church to be careful of their witness, to do all things without murmuring or arguing, so that you may be blameless and innocent, children of God without blemish in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation, in which you shine like stars in the world. Here in chapter 4, he encourages the church, again, to remember to live so that they reveal their faith and to whom they belong. Let your gentleness be known to everyone, he says. The Lord is near. Paul urges us all then to turn our worries into prayer and with thanksgiving bring our requests to God. We remain in the mind of Christ when we reject negative thoughts and think on what is true, honorable, just, pure, pleasing, excellent, commendable, anything worthy of praise. And the promise for those who keep on doing what we have learned, received, and heard and seen, the God of peace will be with you. We rejoice as we welcome 5 new members in the Presbyterian Church of Coshocton today. We give God thanks and praise for you. We embrace you as you are. We hope that you feel God's love here. I am grateful for Margaret Towner and all the women in ministry going back to biblical times whose stories inspire us to be open to the Spirit, bringing change to our church and our society. While it hasn't been as much as Margaret, I have experienced some opposition to my ministry over the years. None of that is worth talking or even thinking about. As Paul says, It's not honorable, excellent, pure, or praiseworthy. I, too, haven't felt that entering into debate about women in ministry is helpful. Not when there's work to be done. We have a lot of work to do, amen? The best thing is to be who we are meant to be and not be ashamed of who we are. I too have been strengthened by the support of family and friends and the certainty that God has called me to this work. I would add to Margaret's list of things that keep her going a sense of gratitude to God for this call. Gratitude is a powerful thing. I give thanks to God for what he has done in my life and is doing in our church. And one more thing I would add to the list is joy. The joy of the Lord is our strength. Amen. No one can take our joy away. Let us make our requests known to the God who loves us and has a plan for us. And remember that in Christ's body, we are made one, in spite of our differences. Remember that your gentleness is part of your witness to the world. Now keep on doing the things that you have learned and received and heard and seen. Give thanks, and may the God of peace be with you. Let us pray. Thank you, Lord, for your love for us, for sending your Son to give his life for our sins, making a way to be reconciled with you and one another when there was no way. Thank you for calling us all now by name to love and serve you and your people, and for giving us joy for this journey, your joy that no one can ever take away. Thank you for all the godly men and women like Margaret Towner who have heard your voice and accepted the call to serve as ministers despite the opposition. Grant us the mind of Christ so that we may all live in peace with one another, forgiving each other as we seek to do the work of your church and reach out with love to our community. Help us to think on things that are honorable, excellent, pure, and praiseworthy, and to be a faithful witness through kindness and gentleness. Amen.
Thank you. You may be seated. I invite Jennifer Austin and all those who are joining our flock to come up to the front. So that would be the Layton family, Linda Weber, Lou Tara, and Betty Harrison. If you'd like to bring your families can come to you. Baptism, you were claimed by God, marked as Christ's own forever, and joined to his body by the Holy Spirit. You come to us then not as strangers, but as friends in Christ and members of the household of God. We rejoice that you now desire to join with this congregation in the worship and mission of the church. Hear these words from Scripture. There is one body and one spirit, just as you were called to the one hope of your calling. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in all. As members of the body of Christ, let us affirm the faith into which we were baptized. I believe in God, the Father Almighty,
maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
I'm wondering if you all could come together and face me. And I can look at you all together. Sarah and Scott, Betty, Linda, and me. We have professed our faith as one body. Will you be a faithful member of this congregation, share in its worship and mission through your prayers and gifts, your study and service, and so fulfill your calling to be a disciple of Jesus Christ? If so, say, I will, with God's help.
I will,
God's help. Let us pray. Holy God, thank you for calling us to be your people and joining us to Christ's body, the church. We praise you for leading Sarah and Scott, Betty, Linda, and Lou to this congregation. Empower us by your Spirit that we might love one another as Christ loved us, honoring him in all that we say and do, giving our lives in service to others, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Friends, remember your baptism and be thankful. Amen. Welcome to the ministry that we share in Jesus Christ. The peace of Christ be with you all. Amen. Let us take a moment and share our joys and concerns with one another. Anyone have something to share? Okay, please join me in a response. Oh, sorry. Yes, honey.
The people of Venice.
Yes.
The city is now under the worst flooding in its history.
Yes, Venice is suffering from severe flooding. I'm praying for the people. Others? Yes, honey.
Joe Skelton. So please keep Margaret, his wife, and their children.
Okay, we will pray for Joe's family. He passed away yesterday. Joe's family.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you for sharing. Others. Yes, Margaret.
When my twin brother had his spinal surgery last week, he had some problems, but he is healing now as he is expected to
do what he's asking about. Okay, Margaret's twin brother had his spinal surgery, and he's doing as well as to be expected, but we need to pray for his continued recovery. Thank you, Margaret. Next, Quinn.
I'd like to pray for
Matthew's
father. He's had a tumor growing in his head, and he really means a lot to me and my favorite girl. That's his first granddaughter. Mm-hmm. So I like a lot of things that happened.
Okay, Quinn is asking for prayers for her fiancé's father-in-law who is suffering with a brain tumor. What is his first name?
His name is Sean.
Sean. Prayers for Sean. Anything else? Okay, let us pray. God of new beginnings, you have promised us a season in which weeping will no longer be heard, nor cries of distress. Yet we live in a season filled with weeping and distress. This day we come before you offering prayers for those who are sick, for those who mourn the loss of loved ones, loss of employment, or the pain of transition.
This day we come before you offering prayers for those who cry out in distress, for those who are hungry, and those without adequate shelter, those struggling with addictions, chronic pain, or depression.
This day we offer prayers for those who labor in vain, those whose jobs don't sufficiently provide for their families, for those whose work hurts their bodies and spirits, for those who don't get enough rest and struggle to find balance in their life. You have promised us a season of blessing.
You have promised us a season of peace.
We pray for the coming of that holy time throughout your beloved creation, for the sake of your beloved Son and our Savior, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. In a world filled with blessings, we celebrate our privilege and our responsibility to share those blessings. Let us celebrate the God of overwhelming blessings by continuing our worship through the offering of our tithes and our lives.
Thank you.
Amen.